I thank you very much, Eliana, for her kind words about my work, and especially I thank my old friend, Moshe Sharon, who spoke about the dedication of my husband to the Jewish people. Maybe we won't have time here, but my husband participated in a very dangerous mission. It was a clandestine mission to save Jewish children from Morocco. And he was received just before he died. He was received by the president of the State of Israel. I was very happy to have participated in my husband's life, because my husband was a person absolutely exceptional. And therefore, I was with him during this mission. Now, about the work that we are speaking about the history of the Jews of the Arab countries and the whole problem of with Islam and jihad, my husband published just before his death a fantastic book on the Jews of Morocco. And the condition of the Jews of Morocco with Professor Paul Fenton, which is in French. And it is full of information about Jewish life and Islam. And this book is now being translated into English. And there will be also a Hebrew translation. So I am very happy that this work of my husband will be available to the Israeli public. Now, I have been invited to speak about the situation of the Muslims in Europe, because Europe has an important impact on the policy of Israel. And in fact, It is not only Europe, but even now America, which has changed its policy with Obama, and which is following in the step of Europe. So, how this policy has developed in Europe? How now the Muslim population is having a determinant influence on the policy of Europe, particularly in the relation, not only, but particularly in the relation with Israel. There are many things that the public here in Israel doesn't know about Europe. So I am happy to speak to you about Europe, so you can lose also your illusions about Europe. First of all, I will speak about the situation of the Muslim population. The Muslim population is very diversified in Europe. It has came in several waves, and in fact, the demography is not known, because first of all, there was numerous waves of immigration into Europe, and the number of Muslims in each European country is a state secret. The European countries, each European countries, give an official number, but it is not the right number. We know it is 2-3 times more than that. It is impossible also to know this the demography, because there are lots of illegal immigrants which are arriving all the time, so no one can know the amount of illegal immigrants. The Muslim population is diversified because it comes from Africa, different Muslim countries of Africa. From Asia, we have Chechen, we have Caucasian, we have Indonesian. So there is a continual amount of Muslim immigrants that comes into Europe for different reasons. And also we have the European population, which is the Albanian, the Kosovar, the Bosnian, the Muslim from Romania, from Hungary, so from Serbia, from Bulgaria. So in fact, it is an enormous Muslim population. Now, this population is very well organized. And it is protected by three transnational bodies, which are very important. One is the Arab League, which is very powerful, because first of all, they are protected by their own government. For instance, if the Muslim Indonesian or Pakistani complain to their government that they are bad treated, there is a complaint from Pakistan to the country that maltreats the Muslims, and there can be reprisals against economic interest of this country in Pakistan. So there is all this, there are 56 Muslim countries that protect the Muslim immigrant into Europe. So this is already quite a weight. Then there is the Arab League, which control important territory, Arab territories, strategic territory, and particularly the oil reserve, world reserve of which is so important for the European economy. Then you have also the Muslim World League, which is a very important body, transnational also, that concentrate, control all a billion and a half Muslim populations. And you have the OIC, which is the Organization of the Islamic Cooperation. It was before the conference. So you have three transnational bodies that that protect the this population. Therefore, the Muslims, under the pressure of the OIC, and particularly the Muslim World League, the European countries have submitted to the Muslim demand of immigration. They could not stop it. They opened the door, they accepted a policy of open door immigration and of development of Islam in Europe. So the Muslims have set up a special school according to the, they have published a booklet in 2000, which is strategy for Islamic education in Europe, and which set up a plan for the Islamization, cultural Islamization of Europe. So in fact, through different instruments, I don't want to be too long, but you will find all the descriptions of all what I am saying in my last book. Now, we have to see that this Islamic population is influencing the culture of Europe, because Islam sees culture in a different way than us. Islam, for Muslims, culture must be conform to the teaching of Sharia. And therefore, we have they pretend that Islam preceded Judaism and Christianity, that all the culture that preceded Islam was Jahiliya culture. It is not worthwhile. And they apply to culture different parameters than us when we research history or culture. We go as we use rational parameters. We use the system of criticism, especially for researching in history. We control, we have to read several documents, and on that we establish a relative, relative truth, because truth can always be wrong in some way, and is always a notion that can evolve and become better. So, but with the Muslim, the truth must be in conformity with the Quran. And therefore, we see that there is a total negation of the the culture of Europe. And this is why Muslim schools must be created in Europe in order to inculcate Muslim education. So we see through this school and through different Muslim apparatus and the mosque and so on, and also the Sharia, which is coming into Europe, like instance, like the blaspheme law, which forbids the criticism of the Quran, of the Sharia, of the Prophet Muhammad, and so on. So we see, therefore, the politically correct discourse, which dominates totally the media and the European culture. So we see that the European culture, there is no more freedom of speech now, and we see, therefore, that the culture of Europe is changing and must adapt to Islamic criteria. So the problem with this situation is that, of course, it contradicts totally the European teaching, cultural teaching, what is taught in school. For instance, you cannot speak about the Shoah. Now, no more in European school, because the Muslims rebel against that. They say it didn't exist. And in relation to Israel, of course, it is the Nakba, the narrative, the Nakba, Palestinian narrative, which is replacing the historical roots of the Jewish people. For instance, we know that we have several, apart from the Bible, we have several documents and in archaeology, in history, among the Roman, among even before, in the pharaonic time, we have several documents speaking of Israel, but for Europe now, it is the Nakba narrative that is taken seriously and not the Israeli history. This is why UNESCO has Islamized Hebron, the tombs of the patriarch. This has been done without, I think Israel has complained, but not any European countries, although the patriarchs are also belong also to Christianity. So it has been done, hence the root of Judaism and Christianity has been Islamized without by UNESCO, because the OIC has asked UNESCO to do it, without any reaction from the Judeo-Christian world. And this is one of example. Now, I spoke to you about the OIC because you have to understand when I speak about multiculturalism, when we speak about politically correct discourse, the politically correct discourse is something that is acceptable to Muslims. And therefore we see in Europe now a whole movement among the archaeologists, among the intellectuals, among the media, to reject the Judeo-Christian history and civilization in order to replace it by multiculturalism, which is in fact a Islamic version of history and culture. It is the Islamization of world history. It is a very important thing that we are living that now. We are in the middle of it, and people don't realize, they don't know it, because Europe itself has accepted this evolution because for several reasons, but you have to understand that the Second World War, after peace, didn't end, and all those ambassadors, ministers, intellectuals that have been Nazi and anti-Jewish, and which have collaborated in a way by their silence or more actively in the genocide of the Jewish people, they remain in post. And especially the diplomats, there was recently an article in that, several articles in that in Spiegel, showing how the diplomats, the modern diplomats now, were a Nazi, former Nazi. And therefore, we see that this policy that Europe have accepted, which is anti-Israeli, and the alliance with the Muslim world against Israel is the continuation of the alliance of the Nazi with the Mufti of Jerusalem, with the Palestinian people, based on the destruction of the Jewish people. Now, in my view, it is this policy which the Europe call the Mediterranean policy, which is in fact the root cause for the destruction of Europe. Because after 73, the European Union, for those who have read my book about Arabia, now the European Union has accepted to create a continent, a union between Europe and the Arab countries, in order to oppose America. But this union was based on the destruction of the state of Israel. This was the condition of the Arab state to get together with Europe, if Europe will accept to recognize the Palestinians and bring back Israel to a very small dimension, to the 67 armistice line. So the basis of this alliance between Europe and the Arab countries brought all these Muslim waves, because Europe has opened its arm to them, on the basis that they will form together with the Arab population one continent, one culture, and in order to create one culture, Europe had to accept the Nakba, the Palestinian narrative, and to forego its own culture. So what we see in Europe now is this transformation, which I have described in my former book, from free people into a state of dimitude. We live now in Europe already in a state of dimitude, but people don't know it. I think that we are going to have in Europe extremely difficult time with because people are waking up, and they will probably, that there are already now everywhere in Europe movements of revolt. Now, the revolt is against their own government, because it is the European government who brought up this situation that has totally destroyed Europe. Because it will go on. And in fact, there are many places in Europe where a European cannot even walk and are aggressed. So, apart from this situation of the Islamization and dimitude of Europe, because European government wanted, because they have accepted also to bow down, to not fight the demands of the OIC. So, and they have developed also a very anti-Zionist culture. Because of that, the situation in Europe is very unstable. But you have to understand what I have explained, because this is the context of Arabia. But you have to understand what I have explained in my last book, which is called Europe, Globalization, and the Universal Coming Caliphate. Because, in fact, in Europe and at least in Europe, we are the people, the populations, cannot impact on their own government. They cannot influence anymore the policy of their own government. Because, first of all, these governments have lost their prerogative, their freedoms, because they form the European Union, they form the European Union, which is a super, it is a transnational, international superstructure. And the population, the French, the English, cannot impact on them. And the rules which are decided by the European Union are overcoming the rules of each European country. So the Europeans have lost their freedom. But also, thanks to globalization, we see now the creation of transnational body which are linked, have created networks, like for instance the UN, to govern the state. We know that the UN, for instance, the rules of the UN will oblige Israel to act according to what it will decide. Because this is globalization. Now, the UN is dominated by the OIC, and all the UN committees and bodies belonging to the UN, like UN, UNESCO and others, all these bodies are totally penetrated by the OIC and under the influence of the OIC. So this is what I have called the universal caliphate. People don't understand, but the world is living now under the rule of the universal caliphate. Now, a body has been created, the Alliance of Civilization, after the bombing of Madrid, Zapatero, because this is how European answer to terrorism. Zapatero accepted with Turkey, the fundamentalist Turkey, to create another body, an international body, which is the Dialogue of Civilization, the Alliance of Civilizations, which is totally under the rule of the OIC and which want to impose over the whole world the Palestinian narrative. That this means that Israel has no history. Israel is an occupying country, and it is the Palestinians who is the real heir of the Israeli, of the people of Israel history. It is not the Jews. So this is what is taught now. This is what is accepted in Europe as in the culture. So in fact, the OIC and the European countries and America have created a whole network, like NGOs, continuous new NGOs which they pay in order to to control what the people read, what the people study, what the people teach, and what they say. We are living under the fascist control of several bodies like that. You will find their name in my book, like the Annalyn Foundation, the same. Multiple bodies that were created only to impose over the people the rule of the universal caliphate and a control, a fascist control, a Stalinist control over what everything what is said, everything what is published, especially concerning Islam and Israel. If you have any questions, I will be happy to answer.
Regarding the rate of birth,